the door, please?
Yep, I'll get it.
Oh, how cute. Huh. It's a package.
What was it for?
I don't know.
What's it say?
It just says, open me.
Well, uh-huh. Open it.
Okay.
Wow.
Look.
Whoa.
Gonna leave me in here? See you next year.
Wow.
It's Jason O's Variety Show. Ho, ho, holiday edition. With Emily Ryan Reed, our band, The Remotes. Tonight, comedian Jim Short, the American Siren, Marcus Goldhaber, and author Ryan Patrick Olson. And now here's the guy putting the J-O in Jolly, Jason O.
Hey, how are you? Welcome to Jason O's Variety Show. I'm Jason Ostrowski. Welcome back. If you're new here, we're glad you're watching tonight. We've got a great holiday show for you. A lot has happened since we saw each other last. I think it was in October we saw each other. We got a new president. There's a vaccine now for COVID, which is fantastic news. And what else? Oh yeah, I died on national TV in a fiery car wreck. I wish there was somebody yelling, "He's okay, folks," after that. Hey, it's that time of year again. People are out there doing their holiday shopping. But this year, people have a little bit of a question to face for themselves. They have to ask themselves, do I get jewelry or toilet paper? Santa Claus is having to make some changes in his deliveries this year. Instead of carrying just a sack full of toys, he will be arriving with two sacks. That's right. One for the toys, and another one for all the cookies that he can't eat while masked up in a stranger's house. Way to be safe, Santa. Many families are having Zoom gatherings this year in lieu of large family gatherings. It's a very smart idea, and there's an uptick to it. When Uncle Joel passes out from too much eggnog, you can just click leave meeting. Many of you probably saw this in the news, but a mysterious metal monolith appeared in the middle of the Utah desert and has since been seen in many different places around the world. I have a theory on this. Stick with me here. I actually think it's an alien meat thermometer telling them, we're done. Speaking of outer space, the White House has announced that the newly minted Space Force will call its members Guardians. Now, some people were surprised, saying, hey, that sounds a lot like the Marvel Comics Guardians of the Galaxy. I don't know why people are surprised. This is the same White House that brought us Doctor Strange. There he is. What a fine-looking gentleman. We've got a great show for you tonight, and in the spirit of Smokey Robinson, I want to wish everybody a Merry Christmas. In case you can see it, Smokey had a little trouble pronouncing the word Hanukkah.
Happy Chanukka. I have no idea what Chanukka is, but happy Chanukka.
Now, to be fair, there's two spellings of it, and Smokey did contact the people and send them a personal apology and a new message. Well done, Smokey. Like I said, we've got a great show for you. We have got so many guests. We've got the remotes here. We've got Emily Ryan Reed, as always, singing for you and singing with me. We have got Jim Short doing comedy for you. A very funny man. We've got the American Siren singing. We've got Marcus Goldhaber. And we've got an author named Ryan Patrick Olson. I recently had the honor of recording the audio version of his book, and I sat down for a little chat with him. You're going to see that a little later in the show. For now, let's get to some music. Thanks for being here.
Well, we're living here in Allentown, and the closing of the factory is down. Out of Bethlehem, the killing time, filling out forms, standing in line. Well, our fathers fought the Second World War, spent their weekends on the Jersey Shore, met our mothers in the USO, asked them to dance, dance with them slow. We're living
Our first guest tonight is a very funny comedian named Jim Short. He's been seen on David Letterman, Conan O'Brien, Craig Ferguson. He's kind enough to join us right here on Variety. In 2004, he was the winner of the San Francisco International Stand-Up Competition. You can follow him right here on Facebook, at Jim Short Comedian. Please give a good old g'day, mate, to our friend in Australia, Jim Short.
Greetings, everyone, and thank you for joining us for this absolutely wonderful Variety Hour. My name is Jim Short, and I'm on quarantine here in glorious Australia. And it's an absolutely spectacular, wonderful December afternoon here at the beach. For those of you who don't know, we have opposite seasons. It's summertime down here right now. So we have a hot summer holiday, which is perfect if you're an adult. It's brilliant. You're by the pool, barbecue going, couple of drinks, Merry Christmas, and a Happy New Year. But as a kid, you're confused. You don't know what's going on. You don't know about the seasons being changed up. You just know it's hot and it's sweaty, and you're watching all these Christmas specials from America. People are dashing through the snow, and it's a winter wonderland, and you're getting sunburned, and you're crying, I want Frosty the Snowman! And your parents, they panic. They're trying to do their best. They find a puddle. Look, kids, it's Frosty. Frosty's sleeping. It's just a spilled over drink with the charcoal from the Barbie. But it was a snowman to us. Then you grow up, you find out all the myths, right? You find out about him, you find out about that one. We find out about Frosty. That's not Frosty. That's Foster's. Australian for snowman. Is that right? Yeah, I think it went quite well. Okay, let's get ready for the next segment then, shall we? Okay, that's good. Let's set up for part two and change the backdrop, thank you. Enough with the beach. So anyway, part two, welcome back. I mean, the Rolling Stones, people have been making fun of them for their age for 40 years. 40 years ago, they said the Stones are old. They're so 40 years ago. Now, that's the beauty of seeing them. They are. They're old. They're old rock stars who should have died decades ago, but they didn't. There's no explanation for their existence. They're like the mysteries of the ancient world, right? They're like the Stonehenge or the pyramids. You don't know how old they are. They're a bit crumbly, but look, they're standing. Well, Mick and Ronnie kind of lean against each other, but they're basically upright. And Mick Jagger, Sir Michael Philip Jagger, Mick Jagger had a massive heart operation last year. He pulled through it fantastically. They went back on the road, and he had an interview after his operation. He said it was a bit weird. He woke up after the operation and he was still in a sort of an anesthetic dream state. He was still a bit drugged up from the operation, and he was in a panic. He thought he was dead. He thought he'd died, and he'd woken up in the morgue surrounded by corpses, and he was freaking out. And then he eventually realized it was just the rest of the band sitting around his hospital bed. Your body tells you when you're getting older, right? Your body lets you know it's all starting to happen. I got out of bed and I couldn't walk. I was asleep. I didn't even do any physical activity. I woke up, I put my foot down and was like, I can't walk. And I don't want to walk and I don't want to get back into bed because that's where it happened. I tell you what, and just the amount of time it takes to be presentable at this age. I've heard about this term, manscaping. Well, I have to do old manscaping. The amount of time I have to spend trimming my ears and my nostrils of the hair that grows, it's a full-time job. You'll go through battery after battery. It's full-time work. You can't even let a day go by without it. And your eyebrows, forget about it. Your eyebrows, they grow while you're trying to cut them. And they're trying to join together. They're trying to become this force on your forehead right there. And my ears, the ears, see, I used to be that guy. I'd be that young dude about 15 years ago. I'd be out and about and I'd see some old fella out there and he'd have like a shrub growing out from the inside of his ears. And I would think, why didn't you tend to that? And at this age, I realise now, he did that this morning. But your body tells you when you're getting older. My eyesight, my close-up vision, it went. wasn't even over a long period of time, wasn't noticeable, wasn't over months, wasn't overnight, it was over the page. I was reading a book, oh yeah, this is great, yeah, ooh, I can't see anymore. And I had to go out and get my reading glasses. That's right. This is your first age old dude badge of honor. There you go, wear these proudly. There you are, there's your old man medal of honor right there. Because that's what happens. Some men, they get to the point where what happens? They look in the mirror and they say, when did I turn into my father? Whereas I peek in the mirror and I think, when did I become Michael Caine? But I'll tell you this, this is exactly how I sum up. This is exactly how old I am right now. This is my age. If I drop anything, I have to think really hard. Do I still need that?
Hey, Emmy.
Hey.
You look really cute in your Christmas sweater.
Thank you, thank you. Tarjay.
Ooh.
I see you're looking very festive, per usual.
Why, thank you, thank you. This is a Santa.
Oh.
As in Claus, Santa.
Got it. Is that the new section at Macy's?
Yes, very exclusive. So do not try to get in. Do not do it. I love this time of year. Look at all the decorations we have here at Variety.
I know.
Did you do this?
Yes, the woman's touch. Dollar General really came through for us this year. We had to budget. We have snow falling in the background. You guys can't see it.
You can't see it, but one of us is going to have to shovel that later. Oh, man. I have a bad back.
Have a holly jolly Christmas. It's the best time of the year. I don't know if there'll be snow, but bring a cup of cheer. Have a holly jolly Christmas. And when you walk down the street, say hello to folks you know and everyone you meet. Ho, ho, the mistletoe. Home where you can see. Somebody waits for it. Kiss her once for me. Have a holly jolly Christmas. It's the best time of the year. Oh my golly, have a holly jolly Christmas this year.
I love that song.
Me too.
It's one of my favorites. You love it too?
Yes.
Do you have any favorites of your own?
Awesome.
Rocking around the Christmas tree at the Christmas party hop. Mistletoe hung where you can see, every couple tries to stop. Rocking around the Christmas tree, let the Christmas spirit ring. Later we'll have some pumpkin pie and we'll do some heavy. Buzz of holly, rocking around the Christmas tree. Have a happy holiday. Everyone dancing merrily in a new old-fashioned way.
That is a good one.
It is it's, my favorite.
Brenda Lee. Oh boy, I just love it. I love this time of year.
Me too. I'm here singing my favorite songs with my very favorite person.
I like cookies.
All right, well, let's do what we practiced.
You got it.
The favorite one, right?
The favorite one.
Have a holly jolly.
We agreed.
Yeah, I know. Let's go.
Have a holly jolly.
The favorite.
Yeah, the favorite.
Got it.
Have a holly jolly Christmas
tree at the Christmas party hop. Mistletoe hung where you can see, every couple tries to stop.
Have a holly jolly
Christmas tree, let the Christmas spirit ring.
Say hello to folks you know, and we'll do some
everyone. You will get
boughs of holly rocking around. Jolly Christmas tree, it's have the a best happy time holiday. Oh, everyone jolly, have a holly jolly Christmas. Old fashioned chain.
Merry Christmas, baby. I love you.
Merry Christmas, honey.
Marcus Goldhaber and I go all the way back to our college days in the 1900s. My God, 1900s. These days, he can be found in New York City bringing his swinging vocal jazz stylings to a new speakeasy in Harlem called Room 623. You can follow him right here on Facebook, at Marcus Goldhaber. Here he is singing Winter Wonderland.
Sleigh bells ring, are you listening? In the lane, the snow is glistening. A beautiful sight, we're happy tonight. Walking in a winter wonderland. Gone away is the bluebird. Here to stay is a new bird. He sings a love song as we go along. Walking in a winter wonderland. In the meadow we can build a snowman and pretend that he is Parson Brown. He'll say, I am married, we'll say, no man, but you can do the job while you're in town. Later on we'll conspire as we dream by the fire to face unafraid the plans that we made walking in a winter wonderland. Build a
snowman, pretend that he is Parson Brown.
He'll say, I am married, we'll say, no man, but you can do the job while you're in town. Later on, we'll conspire as we dream by the fire to face unafraid the plans that we made, walking in a winter wonderland. Walking in a winter wonderland. Walking in a winter wonderland.
Do anything you please.
what I couldn't turn down. I could walk away from anyone I ever knew. I can't walk away from you. I have never let anything have this much control over me. I work too hard to call my life my own. I made myself a world and it works so perfectly. It's your world now, I can't refuse. I've never had so much to lose. Well, I'm shameless.
Patrick Olson is the author of this book right here, Carnival of Heaven. It's a fantastic book, which I just had the opportunity to record the audio version of. It'll be available shortly. I sat down with Ryan to talk about the book, his life, and share a couple laughs along the way. I hope you enjoy. By the way, you can find out more about the book and follow Ryan on Facebook at RPO Author. Let's get to the chat.
How are you?
I'm doing fantastic. How are you, Jason?
I'm good. I'm good, Ryan. It's good to see you. It's been a while, right?
Yeah, about 4 years.
4 years. We met on a cruise competing in The Voice of the Ocean. We were both on vacation and ended up being the show for the week.
I know. It was absolutely insane. I remember getting on stage and doing my bit and then getting off stage, seeing you come on and doing Crocodile Rock by Elton John and just nailing it and just like, okay, well, guess this competition's gone.
You were Billy Idol to a T. I wanted to do Bon Jovi, but the band couldn't transpose it. It was way too high. But sadly, we both lost. We were top three and we lost.
We did.
You know what? We're doing okay. So, Ryan, why don't you tell the folks at home about yourself, where you live, where you're from?
Yeah, I'm from Stony Plain, Alberta, Canada, which is basically up in the Arctic, north of Canada. I live in Goodyear, Arizona now. It's a lot warmer now, which is nice. When I was younger, I was diagnosed with T-cell leukemia, and I was in there at the hospital for about 2 years. So I was basically, for about 8 months solid, was in the hospital and able to leave because of the severity of my cancer. And everyone always told me it would make a great story just because of everything I went through and how I actually survived it. Because to be completely honest with you, none of my doctors actually thought I would. They kept telling and trying to prepare my parents for the worst because that just seemed to be what was inevitable.
Wow.
And yeah, it was a super scary time. Just a super.
How old a guy were you when you were diagnosed?
You wouldn't know it from my book, but I was actually about 6 and a half at the time. You know, and a lot of people would tell you that when you're 6, you probably don't remember a lot of stuff. For whatever reason, be it a blessing or a curse, I remember pretty much everything.
Well, that's pretty traumatic. I mean,
yeah. It absolutely was. I mean, for everybody involved, you know, it took me until writing this book to realize how much of a hardship that had to have been on everybody around me. I'd always been a little bit self-absorbed when it came to that time in my life, because I just thought like, well, this was like 2.5 years of my life that was taken from me and all that kind of stuff. I stopped doing that when I wrote this book because I started realizing there was so much good, so much hope, so much beautiful stuff in the world, beautiful things that people can do and people are able to do during these hard types of times. And I didn't really realize it. Like,
the title of the book is Carnival of Heaven. You wrote a book about this experience. It's an awesome book. I've read it. I had the honor of recently recording the audio version of this book for you. It's been out about a year now, right?
Yeah, about a year now.
How long did it take you to write this book?
2.5 years. Keep in mind, though, that was basically 3 iterations of it. So the first one was unreadable. I'd never written the book before.
My favorite character to read in the audiobook is Lyman, is the villain of your piece. And he, my favorite of anytime he was in one of the chapters, I was like, oh, good. I get to play Lyman today. About a month and a half ago, you reached out to me out of the blue and said, hey, I don't know if you know, but I wrote this book. I want to do an audio book, and I think maybe you'd be good at it. I've never done an audio book. Sent me a copy of the book to read. It was a beautiful story, and it's a hopeful, emotional journey you take the readers on. How would you explain it? Because it's your real story, but there's this dream world that happens.
The intent of the book was to kind of create a type of like Pan's Labyrinth meets like memoir type thing. But it wasn't until the last iteration of it and the last retelling of it that I realized that the point of this thing was actually my cancer meets my depression. So I've dealt with major depressive disorder my entire life ever since that. A lot of that's been survivor's guilt. A lot of that's been a lot of very tough issues. And I ended up exploring that a lot in my book. And it was just, I mean, it was the hardest thing I've ever done in my life. Like, I mean, and I include cancer with that. I mean, I went through 8 months of that, and then I was like, okay, well, life can continue now. And it wasn't, of course, until I was later on in life where I started to kind of digest and process all the stuff that happened back then and realize how much of a burden I must have been to my family and all this type of stuff. And that manifested itself in depression. And I didn't realize that was the story I was trying to tell until much later on.
No, they had to be tough taking a microscope to something that was so tough in your life, but you've grown from it. You've grown incredibly. You know, you're a very positive individual. It's a great read. I really enjoyed reading it. I'll probably read it again, or I won't listen to myself read it. We don't know. We should mention, we don't know yet when the audiobook will be available, but right now the real book is available. So I encourage you to get the real book. I'll put a link where you can go buy the real book. It's fantastic. Christmas is right around the corner, so there's no excuses.
Honestly, like, you brought my work to life in such a way that I never knew it was really imaginable. I mean, when I first heard your voice, I was like, well, this guy's an actual actor. This guy's a guy who uses his voice for a living. I thought, like, honestly, after hearing your voice in The Cruise, I remembered it distinctly because you have a very distinct voice. I imagine, like, if someone had to listen to anyone I knew for 13 hours, it would be him. And so,
you hear that, Mom? Thank you for that. Where can people find it? Where can they go out and get a hold of this for Christmas?
Well, Amazon.com, and actually it'll be available on Audible with the voice of Jason here in probably a couple of weeks. It takes about 30 days for it to get there, but once it does, it'll be available for that as well.
Anyway, Ryan, I thank you so much for coming on here and talking about the book. Go out, buy it, and then get it again when the audio book comes out. But thank you. I hope you guys have a happy holiday.
And you too. Thank you so much for this. I really, really appreciate this. This is quite the honor. I know you're like, oh no, but it absolutely is an honor for me. This is the first time I've ever been interviewed about my book. And I got to tell you, it's a very cathartic thing for me. So thank you so much.
Well, hopefully there's much bigger and better interviews on the horizon for you, Ryan.
You never forget your first.
Thanks for being here and doing this, though.
Thank you so much.
For more about Carnival of Heaven, visit RyanPatrickOlson.com.
Do you ever write your own music? Occasionally, I do. For instance, I wrote the theme song that you hear at the top of this show. That was a lot of fun to do. But I haven't written anything with lyrics in a while. I wrote one song about 2 years ago with Emily called Rely on Me, which was actually featured on the very first show we did. But I just wrote a new song. I was inspired in quarantine. It's called Pretty Good Year. It's available right now on iTunes or anywhere that you stream your music. I want to give a very special thanks to Trevor Jones for helping me out. He supplied the guitar and percussion you hear on the song. I hope you enjoy it. Here's Pretty Good Year.
It started off as Pretty Good Year, uh-huh. 2020, nothing to fear, Well, then things got complicated and the world went mad. Instead of cruising around the world, I'm in lockdown getting fat. Singing songs in the basement, trying to find a way back. Every day is just a brand new distraction. Nothing more than political inaction. Every day. Take them to the streets. Family versus family. Some got nothing to eat. Huh. A pretty good year. Pretty good year. Is my sarcasm clear? It's a pretty good year. Lines are longer. Divides getting stronger.
This next song I'm going to play is one of my favorite Christmas songs. It always has been. Usually I repost a video of me singing and playing it from like 10 years ago. But this season I figured I would bring it back out and do a fresh version for Variety, of course. So here we go. You're all going to know it. And happy holidays. Yourself a merry little Christmas. Let your heart be light. From now on, our troubles will be out of sight. Have yourself a
ago this week, I was getting ready to debut my stage show called Sing Us a Song right here in Rochester, New York at the Downstairs Cabaret. I was supposed to do it again this year, but we all know what happened. The Queen's Gambit showed up on Netflix and everybody got sidetracked. But hopefully next year we can be together again live. I can do my show for you. You can request songs and hear my story. So I thought it'd be nice to share a moment from that show. Joining me on stage are Jerry Didak on keyboards, Angel Gonzalez on bass, Jeffrey McBay on drums, and James Allen Baruto on guitar. Here we are doing a little song called Piano Man.
It wouldn't be a piano show without it, I guess. All right, this is our last one. Drive safe after this and then. Have a happy new decade. It's nice.
There's some place that we'd rather be.
Everybody who loaned their talents to us to provide you some entertainment this month. I want to thank you for tuning in and continuing to support me and Varieteen. I appreciate you so much. Remember, don't take anything for granted. Treat each other with care. I hope you have a happy holiday and a happy new year, and we'll see you in 2021.